Good morning and welcome to the 19th and what we believe is the final meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. Parliamentary business being what it is, we can't ever say anything with any certainty currently, but we believe it's our last meeting. Colleagues, first item is just to agree that we'll take agenda item 4 in private, unusually kind of midstream. Are we content with that? We are, thank you. And then we move to agenda item 2, which is a consideration of continuing petitions. And the first of those, it builds on the visit we enjoyed to Parliament a fortnight ago of Stanley, the Golden Eagle. And we are therefore this morning discussing petition number 1859, retain falconers' rights to practice upland falconry in Scotland. This has been lodged by Barry Blyther, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Animals and Wildlife Act 2020 to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. And the committee will recall that we did hear directly from Barry Blyther about these issues at our last meeting. And I once again would like to thank Barry, Stanley, and Roxanne, was it, I think, yeah, for their contribution and assistance. We are joined this morning, good morning, to Mary McCallan, MSP, the Minister for Environment and Land Reform. Welcome to you. To Hugh Dignan, Head of Wildlife Management Unit at the Scottish Government, and Stan Whittaker, Wildlife Manager for Nature Scot. Thank you all very much for being here. We've got a lot to get through today, so it is an early start, so we're grateful for you being here. Members of a number of questions we'd like to explore this morning. Is there anything you'd like to say before we do move to those questions?
Yes, I could give a few opening remarks if that would
be
helpful.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much,
just
Minister.
Just to set the scene, Convener. Thank you. And thanks for the committee for inviting me along this morning to give evidence on this petition. We have previously said, and I would reiterate today, that we absolutely recognise the cultural significance of falconry. Indeed, I'm currently taking the Hunting with Dogs Bill through Parliament, and at stage two consideration there, I rejected some amendments which I felt could unjustifiably impinge on the legal activity. However, it's very much our view that hunting with birds of prey must be undertaken within the law. Mountain hares are now a protected species following the passage of the Animals and Wildlife Penalties Protection and Powers Scotland Act in June 2020, which of course, as the committee will have heard, means that mountain hares are protected from 1 March 2021. And this means that they can no longer be taken for sporting or recreational purposes. Mountain hares, they were protected principally due to concern around them having unfavourable, inadequate conservation status, together with the very real concern of many stakeholders and the public about the number of mountain hares that were killed each year. Now, on that conservation status, mountain hare is a priority species for conservation under the UK Biodiversity Action Plan and is also on the Scottish Biodiversity List. This means that they are of principal concern and importance for biodiversity conservation. And of course, we are living in a climate and nature emergency. However, I would point out that birds of prey still can be used to take mountain hare for other purposes where that's carried out under licence, and that's dictated by section 16.3 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981. So I appreciate that a lot of the discussion has been about the risk that falconers can take non-target species such as mountain hares when they're being exercised and when they're hunting legitimate quarry such as rabbits. Section 9 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act makes it an offence for a person to intentionally or recklessly kill, injure or take a wild animal. And of course, and we may get into some discussion about what constitutes intentional or reckless act, but it's suffice to say that accidental behaviour does not constitute unlawful behaviour in that regard. But ultimately, as with any criminal offence, it's up to Police Scotland and to the Crown Office to consider the evidence in the circumstances. Equally, I would point out that prior to mountain hares being given all year-round protection on the 1st of March, they were included in Schedule 5A of the Wildlife and Countryside Act of 1981, which contains that list of animals protected in their close season. And I point that out because falconers have had to contend with open and closed season for many years, and that gives me confidence that they are able to conduct their activities in a way which abides by different requirements at different times. But I know that you'll have a lot of questions, the convener and your committee, so I can leave it there, but I would stress at the end that I do recognise the cultural significance of falconry and those who practice it. I'm always open to views on the adequacy or the implementation and the impact of legislation. But I would stress the decision was taken on the basis of conservation concerns, and I think that curtailment of activity for sporting purposes is justified in the face of that.
OK, thank you. I mean, at the previous evidence session of the committee, the petitioner clarified that this petition is in relation to upland falconry and that there are different practices and different types of falconry. It's upland falconry which is relevant to the consideration that we have here as a committee in this petition. What is your understanding of upland falconry, and in what way do you understand it to differ from other falconry practices?
So I appreciate the petition is focused on upland falconry, but for the purposes of making legislation, for the purposes of policy development, I have to take falconry as a practice in the round, because we haven't, and I don't think we would, make law for different types of falconry in different places. However, I understand, and particularly with relevance to the mountain hare, that there is a density of mountain hare in the uplands, particularly on land that is managed for as moorland, which means that it has been an area where falconers have practiced that activity. And obviously, with the density of mountain hare there is a propensity for that to have been the quarry that was pursued. And I suppose the type of falcon is another difference that you could find between different practices in the uplands and other areas. But again, I think that comes down to the quarry that's being pursued. So you might find that smaller falcons are used in other parts of the country for different quarries, smaller quarry. And then I think there is a small number of people who use falcons as large as an eagle. And that will be to take the larger quarry, including previously mountain hare. I don't know if there's anything that could be added to that, Hugh.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that one of the sort of key aspects of what would define upland falconry would be the prey species that are available in the uplands. And as the Minister said, mountain hares will be a key part of that. In some parts of Scotland, mountain hares are found in pretty limited parts of Scotland in high numbers. But one of the other species which I think is routinely hunted by falconers in the uplands is grouse, which again, is an upland species and can be hunted without a licence, just with the permission of the landowner during the grouse open season. So I think it's the type of prey that's available is to a large extent dictating the sort of falconry that goes on in the uplands.
So your understanding of it is entirely restricted to the quarry that you believe that these birds are trying to hunt, and not actually to the landscape and the natural landscape which allows them to fly?
I think obviously the landscape has a bearing, but we would say that
without it,
I'm not sure that that's the case. I think they can take off in other parts of the country, and obviously a trained falconer knows a great deal more about that than I do, than we do. But we would say that the quarry that was being pursued is the principal factor which differentiates upland falconry from other types, albeit that there are other variables. Stan, did you want to...
Just to say that golden eagles do live in relatively low-lying habitats on the west coast and on our islands, peregrines and other species used for upland falconry have quite happily taken up residence in many of our towns and cities, so they will happily fly and hunt in lowland situations.
Okay. Yeah. Does the Scottish Government value falconry?
Yes, in the same way that I value other cultural heritage, sporting, recreational parts of Scottish culture. I accept that it's important to the people who practice it, and I accept that there are economic advantages to its practice in the countryside.
The 220 Act, the Animals and Wildlife Penalties Protection Powers Act, the amendment which dealt with the ban on shooting of mountain hares was passed at stage three. Is it correct to say that the Scottish Government did not consider any evidence whatsoever from falconers in relation to that measure?
Well, Mr Ewing, I understand you were the Cabinet Secretary at the time, so...
I wasn't the Cabinet Secretary responsible for that, no.
Well,
no, I wasn't.
The minister that took it forward was the junior minister of both yourself and Ms Cunningham. But no, you're quite right. The amendment that dealt with this issue was one that came at stage three of the bill. And because of that, the Scottish Government wasn't able to undertake the business and regulatory impact assessment, for example, that we normally would have. But as I said in my opening remarks, I, as now the minister responsible, am always, firstly, open to monitoring the impact of legislation and equally to hearing concerns about its effect.
Right. It's factually correct to say that falconry wasn't mentioned. There was no evidence about falconry. Nobody mentioned falconry at all in stage three, and there was no evidence submitted, and nobody from the falconry world had the opportunity to be heard. Is that right?
Well, again, owing to the speed with which stage three happened and the amendment, we weren't able to do the normal statutory assessments before the legislation was passed. However, NatureScot worked very closely with a whole range of stakeholders in the aftermath of the bill to design the licensing scheme which went along with the protected status of the mountain hare, and that included, I think, the Scottish Hawk Board and others.
But I've just... If you don't mind, Minister, I would want just to press you, just to be clear about the point, because I do think it's factually incontrovertible that the falconry world had no opportunity to be heard. They were not consulted, they were not mentioned, and there was no evidence whatsoever presented, submitted, discussed or mentioned by anybody during the passage of the bill about falconry in relation to mountain hares. Is that factually correct?
I accept that the normal assessment wasn't able to be undertaken because of the time. I do accept that point. I don't accept that the falconry community could not have been heard, because, as you know, when you're taking legislation through as a minister, you have an open door.
Did anyone reach out to them? Did Mr Dignan say to the falconers, Mr Dignan, did you say, excuse me, but this amendment has come forward and we think you might be affected? Did that happen?
I don't recall specifically speaking to falconers at the time.
Can you maybe check that out? Just moving on, I mean, you said, Minister, that falconry could be carried out in other parts of the country. We've heard from the petitioner that the only part of the country, and they've looked into this, that they would be able to practice their sport without risking prosecution is Heart Hill Service Station. So which other parts of the country do you think, because you've said that they can carry their sport in other parts of the country, which other parts of the country can they carry out their sport legitimately and without fear of prosecution should their birds take mountain hares?
Well, I think the last part of your question there really sets the context, because we are only talking about mountain hare as being the one quarry which is now protected owing to this change in the law. And the spectrum of other quarry that falconers can take are still available to them. And equally, I would point out that even, you know, despite the protected status of the mountain hare, they still can be taken under licensable purposes. So there's two examples. For other quarry and for mountain hare under licence, where falconers can still take mountain hare and other quarry. And in fact, on that, I might pass over to Stan from NatureScot, because I understand that some licences have been given since the 1 March implementation date, and that might give us a bit of an insight into where this practice is ongoing in Scotland.
Yeah, so we've issued 21 licences for control of mountain hares to prevent serious damage to young trees and natural habitats. So most of the control is by shooting, but at least one land manager has approval to use falconry. Admittedly, most of these will be areas with recently planted trees. Some of them may not be that large. A proportion of those would be suitable for hunting over.
Is this a serious answer to the question? For something like a golden eagle, it'll be flying through trees. Is that really the proposition that you're presenting to us?
Trees about, less than 2 feet high.
The whole point is that it's when the trees are young.
Is it not the case that the licence is afforded as a method of pest control and is completely unworkable for large birds such as eagles, risk of serious injury to the birds?
The licence is about control, and it is about protecting young timber. It is about protecting agricultural land. It is about conserving natural habitats. And that brings me back to the point that I made at the beginning, which is that owing to the conservation status of the mountain hare, it's been viewed by this Parliament and by the public as not being appropriate.
Minister,
please let me finish the point. As not being appropriate.
You've made the point, Minister, and we obviously have limited time.
Purposes.
I don't need you to repeat points.
If you repeat the questions, I'll repeat the points.
I haven't repeated the question. You indicated that the licence was an adequate method of control, and it clearly is not. The petitioner made the point that if everybody with a bird of prey, a falcon, let it loose every day during the open season, and every day it hunted a hare, it would take 50 years for those birds of prey to have hunted as many hares as are shot in 1 year. Are birds of prey seriously a threat to the conservation of mountain hare?
Well, I'm going to pass over to my colleague Hugh in a second, but the correction I would make to that point is that not all falcons can or would take a mountain hare.
Yes,
so
but you...
Really
you,
only you, an eagle would.
Your comment a moment ago was that the birds could hunt other prey legitimately, just not mountain hare. Is the eagle supposed to have some sort of education as to which of the animals on the ground it's allowed to hunt?
No, it's the responsibility of the falconer.
And is that really practical in the context of upland falconry with a golden eagle?
Well, I understand that it's a new challenge for Falkners, of
it's a challenge you really didn't give any consideration to during the passage of the legislation, because you didn't give any thought whatsoever to taking evidence from people who would have been able to give an opinion.
As I've said, the late stage of the Stage 3 amendment.
That's not an excuse for poor legislation.
It's the reality.
Mr. Dignan, is there something you want to say?
On the separate point but related point that you were asking about where people can fly these birds, I would just make the point that the risk of taking a golden eagle, taking a mountain hare, is clearly high if you fly them in areas of high mountain hare density. And that is really only where you have managed grouse moors. In the rest of upland Scotland, which is by far the majority of upland Scotland, and where eagles currently exist and currently fly in the wild, mountain hare numbers are at very low densities. And so if a falconer had decided to fly their bird in any part of upland Scotland other than on the grouse moor, the chances of taking a mountain hare accidentally are very low and would not be considered by most people to constitute intentional or reckless conduct in taking a mountain hare. So I think there are plenty of other prey species. There are other species that eagles take in the wild, and there's no reason why someone shouldn't be flying those birds in those areas of Scotland where mountain hares don't exist in the very high densities that they do on managed grouse moors.
The trouble with that is that from the point of view of the falconer, if the falconer lets his bird of prey go and the bird of prey takes a hare and population of hares is okay, it's concentrated in grouse moors where the land is properly managed, but there are population of hares elsewhere, And therefore, the problem that falconers have is that practising their sport exposes them to prosecution.
Well, I mean,
is that factually correct, or do you dispute that?
Well, it does, in the same way that there is a risk of the golden eagle taking any other protected species.
Well, okay,
so golden eagles are known, for example, to take...
Just moving on from that.
Well, could I finish the point?
Well,
the golden eagles are
you've
known...
answered the question, so I would really rather move on. You see, what happened here is that without any opportunity to be heard, a group in society in Scotland were made into potential criminals. A criminal offence was created without their actually having any opportunity to give any evidence in their own parliament before they were subject to potential prosecution. And what the petitioner is therefore asking is that the law is amended to allow mountain hares to be hunted for the purposes of falconry. I just wanted to pursue the point that you raised, which is that the evidence we've heard is that the practice of falconry in Scotland is fairly restricted. It's not a huge sport. There's a relatively small number of people involved and a small number of birds of prey involved. And the number of hares which are actually taken as a result of falconry activity is just infinitesimal. And therefore, surely the Scottish Government should agree with the petitioners and grant the petition, because the impact on the population of hares is negligible.
Convener, you've stopped me talking before when I've tried to answer the question, yes, which has been posed before, so I won't address the first part of Mr. Ewing's question again. But what I would say is, firstly, I am always open to considering the impact of legislation. Secondly, the decision to protect the mountain hare is based on evidence of a risk of their conservation status. I can hear Mr. Ewing thinking to himself, what's the impact on the conservation status of falconry? But I would respond to that by saying, as lawmakers, we have to be able to take consistent decisions across the piece. So why would it be justifiable, and this is a question for us all, why would it be justifiable to have an exception to a protected species for sporting purposes if we were saying that for all of those who for example, needed to control them in circumstances, for example, on grouse moors, why should the treatment be different between both of those purposes? So not only do I need to respond to threats to conservation status in a nature emergency, but I also have to be mindful of taking decisions which are consistent across the piece for all of those who would seek to hunt in the countryside.
If that argument applies and falconry cannot be carried out because it might take a few mountain hares, even although, and you haven't really answered the question, I'm afraid, Minister, about the actual factual impact of falconry on hares, but the evidence we have heard already, which you've seen, is that it's negligible, it's infinitesimal, it's nugatory, it's irrelevant. But even so, despite that, and you haven't disputed that evidence, and if Minister, you have further evidence on this, or Mr. Dignan has, of a factual nature, I would be very grateful if you could supply us with it after this meeting. But the point I want to make and just put to you is this. What you're saying is that falconry is finished. You cannot practice falconry because those who practice it have the risk that they are carrying out a criminal activity. Therefore, they cannot practice their sport in Scotland. And you're saying that that is correct and it's justified because of a law which was passed in respect of which they had no opportunity whatsoever to be heard. Isn't that really quite a preposterous proposition?
Convener, my colleague Hugh Dignan, I think, answered that point thoroughly in his previous response, which was about all of the ways in which falconry can continue in Scotland despite the change in the law.
I'm going to bring in David Torrance because when we talk about the distinction that you said you cannot have. The petitioner's argument, of course, is that there are natural behavioural characteristics. Well, there's clearly a natural behavioural characteristic difference between someone shooting hares with a gun and a bird displaying its natural characteristics that it has exhibited here in Scotland for it's estimated some 5,000 years, now made illegal. Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Mr. Whitaker, in your earlier statement, you says that, and we're talking about golden eagles here, buzzards, that fly in the west coast of the islands. There's very little obstructions there. These birds need to fly in the uplands. And their natural instinct is, when they see a hare, whether it's a mountain hare or an animal, they will go and take it. Can I, and I'm going to ask about legislation and animal welfare here. Some of these birds will never, ever fly again because of a threat to the owners of prosecution. Does this legislation break the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006?
Is that a question to me?
To the Minister, please.
All right.
So, a couple of points to that. I don't accept that falcons can no longer be used because of this. It goes back to how Hugh described the multitude of activities that can continue in Scotland with falcons. We've pointed to them being used for a whole range of quarry. You know, we're only talking about mountain hares here. They are used to take other species, but equally in the case of mountain hare, they can still be used for licensable purposes. But you know, this point is put to me frequently when it comes to legislation on wildlife management in the countryside, about what's the impact on the dog, for example, in the hunting with dogs, what's the impact on the falcon. And I have to say, you know, I take all that into account, but you're right to point to the 2006 Act, because that means that the keeper of any wild animal, sorry, any animal, not wild animal, the keeper of any animal has a responsibility to make sure that it doesn't cause it any unnecessary pain or suffering and looks after its welfare. So that is the case regardless of changes to the law.
Minister, if some of these golden eagles can't fly in their natural habitat because of the threat that it might take a mountain hare, how is an owner of one of them meant to allow it to fly if he's going to be prosecuted?
My colleague Hugh has mentioned to me that he'd like to come in.
Well, I would just make the point that the risk of prosecution for an eagle taking a mountain hare is no different from the risk of prosecution that's existed for many years for an eagle taking any number of other protected prey species which form part of its natural diet. And they could be things like a golden plover, could be a curlew, could be a red squirrel, could be an adder. All of these things could be a baby pine marten. All of these things are protected species. All of them are known to be part of the diet of golden eagles. So for many years, falconers don't, that's a risk they work with, they manage, and they don't direct their birds onto those sort of species. And in the same way that they can do that with mountain hares. So I don't accept that this is a new unmanageable risk that means that falconers have got to keep their birds at home. It's simply not the case. There are plenty of other protected species that have been similarly there that have posed a similar risk to prosecution. And as far as I'm aware, there has never been a prosecution for a falconer accidentally taking a protected species.
And I think just to add to what you said there, Hugh, and it comes back again to your comments earlier about the best way to manage that being about the understanding the density of the protected species and operating in areas where you're least likely to encounter them.
Do the petitioners ask me for the Scottish Government to invite the Procurator Fiscal or the Rod Advocate to issue guidance indicating that no prosecutions will be taken in respect of the practice of falconers of their sport?
No.
Well, in that case, they are open to prosecution. So we're back at square one, Minister.
I think it would be, I think, I don't think there's
Scotland being criminalised without the opportunity.
Yeah. Convener, I think it would, I think it would be a highly unusual activity for any law officer in Scotland to issue guidance saying that a criminal offence was not going to be prosecuted.
It strike me, though, from Mr Dignan's explanation there that maybe we had an explanation as to why no evidence was taken at the time of the legislation, because it's clear Mr Dignan didn't think it was necessary to take any evidence because he'd already determined that there was no issue involved.
As it happened.
In other words, the evidence would have been pointless because it's quite clear from the exposition you've just given that you didn't think that there was any merit in taking any evidence because, as far as you were concerned, the issue was clear-cut.
Well, I mean, to be absolutely clear about this, I wasn't actually present, and I was away at the time that this happened. But if I had been here, I think the focus was very much on, was it necessary to protect the mountain hare, and the conservation status of the mountain hare was the primary focus of the consideration. There were a number of people we knew who were not keen at all on mountain hare being given that protected status, not least people like the Scottish gamekeepers and recreational shooters of mountain hares. And I think that falconry would have been a subset of that, those people. But I mean, I think that that counter-argument to protection was certainly considered at the time. Whether the specific needs of falconry were considered at the time, I couldn't say, because I wasn't here. And I, given the speed of events at the time, I understand it would have been quite difficult to do that. But I mean, the point that I'm making now is really that that as it turns out, the position of mountain hares and falconers is no different from falconers in relation to other protected species, of which the uplands are full. All wild birds are protected. Wild birds like waders, grouse, form a significant part of a golden eagle's diet. And falconers manage that risk in the same ways that they're perfectly capable of managing it with mountain hares.
Stanley, who we met last a fortnight ago, hasn't flown for 2 years.
Well, I can't explain that.
Sorry?
I can't explain that, I'm sorry.
Well, he hasn't flown for 2 years because of the risk of prosecution, should he do?
Well, as I say, I would find it very surprising that a falconer couldn't find a place in upland Scotland where there was sufficiently low density of mountain hares for them to fly their eagle with no particular concern about it taking a mountain hare rather than any other protected species that might be present.
Mr. Whittaker, could I ask you what Nature Scots' view is of the impact of falconry on mountain hare populations in Scotland?
So we don't have accurate figures for how many mountain hares were taken previously by falconers, but if it was say 1,000 a year were caught, as one of the other people giving evidence suggested,
a falcon went out every day and every day hunted only a mountain hare, then you would get to 1,000. But I mean, that on the law of probabilities isn't very high, is it? Because we've just had all your colleagues here say to us that, you know, that they think it would be very unlikely that there would be a prosecution because, you know, an accidental hare being hunted would be such a rare event.
Other falconers that we've spoken to about, when we've consulted them about this issue, have said that they'll go out and take 6 a day if they're specifically going after mountain hares and maybe hunting over a 6-week period. So that one falconer could, you know, take 60 to 100 hares.
You would accept that 1,000 hares in that scenario we've described, compared with the 26 to 38,000 that would be shot?
Well, we're talking about slightly less than 1% of the population. The population does fluctuate quite considerably. And the in the overall mortality of mountain hares, and this survival rate for mountain hares year to year is maybe, you know, 50% at best. So that number of mountain hares would be insignificant at the population level, but that doesn't mean it might not have an impact at a local level.
Okay, so if it's 1%, it's 1,000 maybe taken by birds of prey. 26 to 38,000, an absolute maximum of 50,000 a year shot. Is the legislation, do you think, proportionate in terms of the impact it's therefore had on those who fly birds of prey?
I don't know if we have a view on the proportionateness of legislation.
Policy question, yeah. To be fair. We act on the basis of advice that Nature Scot give us on the conservation status and the risk of animals, but it's for us to make those decisions. I would come back to the point. First of all, Convener, I absolutely accept that there is a marked difference on the numbers that will be taken by Shooting Mountain here and those that would be taken through Falconry. But if we come back to the core point, which is that our statutory advisers, Nature Scott, telling us in a nature emergency that there is a conservation risk to Mountain Hare, we have to be prepared to take action in the face of that. And it has to be action which is proportionate, but equally which is consistent. And again, I would acknowledge the concerns of the petitioner and everything that the committee is saying. But equally, I would say that how could we justify, and this is a question that I consider, how could we justify taking action which restricted the ability for people to take the animal for recreational purposes with shooting and not apply the similar conditions on those who would take it by other means? It's about consistency. And as I said, for example, through the Hunting with Dogs Bill that's currently being considered, we are grappling with those consistency questions in all the ways that people seek to hunt with dogs in the countryside. We have to have a consistent approach.
Thank you. A supplementary from Mr. Torrance, then Mr. Sweeney.
Minister, if Nature Scott's advising you, and Mr. Whitaker there just in the earlier session has just admitted that they have no idea how many mountain hares are taken from golden eagles or buzzards, how could the government take advice like that if Nature Scott have no idea about what's happening?
The advice that we took from... I don't think that Mr. Whitaker was saying that they have no idea. I think what he said was that we don't have collected figures on that.
That's basically...
It's not, because we have Nature Scott officers who are integrated into their communities and who understand a great deal of what's happening in the communities that they are part of. But the point is, the advice that we took from Nature Scott was on the conservation status as a whole, and we had to respond to that.
Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, so far for your points. The point we were making about balancing and being consistent about legislation, I note a point made by our witness, Mr. Blyther, at his session with us recently, where he said that if you look at the Wildlife and Countryside Act of 1981, for the very same reason, there is an exemption from the legislation that protects birds for explicitly the purposes of falconry. Nature Scott has suggested does not understand why the same derogation has not been applied in the legislation that is relevant to mammals, and indeed does not support such an omission. All that is required to correct that is a small amendment to the legislation to bring mammal and bird legislation into line. Such an amendment would be far less complicated than that which has already been imposed, and would not require any change to primary legislation. And, you know, it's a 40,000-year-old art of falconry. It's a UNESCO-protected intangible cultural practice. It's been carried out in Scotland since at least the Norman conquest and you know, the emergence of medieval society in Scotland. You know, to balance the cultural practices, to balance the minimal risk in practice in reality, and the fact that there is a precedent there in regards to birds of prey feeding on other birds as opposed to mammals, is there a potential to make a minor amendment that would give that comfort to falconers to carry out their practice as a protected cultural practice in Scotland for 1,000 years or so? And that would give a decent balance and allow this issue to be resolved amicably. I just think that on the balance of risks, it's probably quite a useful way to proceed, perhaps.
Thank Mr. Sweeney for his point, and I understand that that's the premise of the petitioner's petition. And as I've said, I will consider all suggestions, and I will consider all of the ways that the legislation that we pass impacts the people who are affected by it. It comes back to the fact, though, that my contention today is that the interference in the ability of falconers to take mountain hare, which I understand is an interference, albeit that, as Hugh has pointed out, still can take place elsewhere, and falconers are still able to take other species. I do believe today that remains justified on the backdrop of the conservation concern of the mountain hare. But of course, I'm very open to considering the concerns.
This has been an eye-opening session, Minister, and I am staggered at some of the responses so far. The complete understanding of the situation and circumstances that we've already heard this morning. Now, the Scottish Government talk about when we come to the licensing system. The Scottish Government believe that the licensing scheme for the control of mountain hares does not have an impact on the ability of Faulkners to enable their birds to exhibit normal behaviour patterns. We've heard that the licensing scheme is unworkable, completely and utterly unworkable. So do you actually believe that statement? Because that is not the case from the profession, from the organisation who have the ability to understand what's taking place. But the Scottish Government fundamentally believes so. Do you still believe that's the case?
Can you just repeat the statement?
Yeah. The Scottish Government believe that the licensing scheme for the control of mountain hares does not impact on the ability of Faulkners to enable their birds to exhibit normal behavioural patterns.
I think the point, the statement that I would make is that it's the protection of the mountain hare, not the licensing scheme itself. The licensing scheme is an example of how, despite the ban, falconers who operate with golden eagles do still have the opportunity to take mountain hare.
The licensing scheme is unworkable in the situations by the profession. They have indicated that it's completely unworkable because their birds are not able to deal with the normal behavioural patterns.
Well,
and you've already indicated that I think 21 scheme or 21 licences have been issued, which is a small number of licences.
Well, I would pass over to Nature Scott to answer whether that was a small number of licences, given the legislation has only been in force for a short period of time.
Yes, so just to clarify, these were licences mostly to protect young forestry plantations and some natural regeneration schemes. So 21 licences. Before the change in the legislation, we issued a similar number of licences to protect
shooting.
This is for taking mountain hares. So it's mostly for shooting. It can be for taking with birds of prey if that's what the land manager wishes to do.
So you are indicating the majority of these 21 are for shooting. Is that the case?
All except one. Yes.
Okay, so there's only one licence that has been issued that would request to deal with the profession. We're dealing with the birds of prey.
Well, if Stan's telling us that's the case, that's the case. But
do you not believe, Minister, that that's a very, very small number of licences that have been issued
It depends on the context. I mean, this has only been in force since March 2021, and I think that division of licences reflects what the discussion we were having previously about the fact that they are far more frequently taken by shooting than by falconers. That's just a reflection on the state of play.
The birds haven't flown for 2 years. Mr. Turns.
No, I'm fine. Yes.
That's been answered. Mr. Ewing.
Yes. This petition, Minister, was lodged on 24th of March 2021. So it's 18, 19 months that the Scottish Government has had to consider this. And indeed, we did get an initial reply about a year ago. Whilst I hear what you say, that you're willing to consider solutions, we haven't heard any this morning. And the impression that I get, and I can't speak for my colleagues, is that the Scottish Government has absolutely no intention of coming up with a solution, that Nature Scott have done nothing to reach out to the falconry world, that the evidence that you have is scant or to non-existent, and that so far as falconry is concerned, it may as well be finished under the Scottish Government approach. And if I'm wrong, and I very much hope that I'm wrong, Minister, prove it. Come up with a solution that allows the sport of falconry to continue for centuries in the future as it has in the past. That's what we're asking for. I've suggested one which you dismissed immediately, out of hand. What are your solutions? Because what we've heard is that a group of Scottish society that is small, but nonetheless you say you value, is getting no support, consideration, sympathy whatsoever from the Scottish Government. And I, for one, feel that's quite shocking.
Thanks, Convener. If the solution that Mr. Ewing is referring to is that I instruct law officers to make a statement that a criminal offence will not be prosecuted, then I think that Mr Ewing is doing a disservice to his legal profession that he was once part of. That is it's just not a realistic solution whatsoever. The Scottish Government, I've got them in front of me, has made three written submissions to this committee. I'm here today and I'm here in good faith. I do not believe that the changes made to the protection of the status of one species is undermining to the extent that Mr Ewing suggests the practice of falconry in Scotland. We have to bear in mind that the golden eagle is probably the only species of falcon that would be large enough to take a mountain hare. Falconers use a range of other species, and there are a range of other quarry that can be pursued. Not only that, but there is a licensing scheme for the protection of young timber, of agricultural land, for the preservation of natural habitats, which allows the taking of mountain hare. And that would be an opportunity for those with golden eagles to be involved in exercising and using their birds in that way. And all of that, I do believe, is justified on the basis of the advice from our statutory advisors, Nature Scots, on the conservation status.
Because earlier, and this is, I suppose, just a final point, and I appreciate the fact that you're here and in good faith, and it's been quite testy because we've become quite exercised, I think, across all parties in the consideration of this petition and the evidence we've received. But you say the advice from Nature Scott, but I'm trying to understand the circumstances, because this was a stage three amendment. You said earlier that none of the normal practices or procedures were entered into. We've established from questions from Mr Ewing that there was no outreach, there was no evidence taken, there was no mention of falconry whatsoever, and then this stage three amendment. What were the circumstances that arose for this amendment to the legislation at stage three? Did somebody sort of pick up the phone or push open the door and say, heck, we've just realised we've forgotten all about falconry in this legislation, we better rush through a stage three amendment? I mean, you're saying the advice from Nature Scott. The advice from Nature Scott was not received at any point during the progress of the bill. It was received as a sort of an afterthought, so that you entered into an amendment at stage three with no consultation, no consideration or no discussion.
Thanks, Convener. I think it's important that we accurately reflect the situation and we use language that's accurate. You have just put to me that I said earlier that none of the normal processes were followed. That's just simply not the case. What I said is that the business and regulatory impact assessment that we would normally have wanted to undertake wasn't possible because of the late stage of the amendment. Now, you've asked practically what happened. An amendment was put forward by a party not in government, and as normal, the government considers how it's going to approach that stage three amendment. Now, of course, it coming at stage three means that it didn't form part of the substantive scrutiny and debate up until that point. But when it is put in front of the Scottish Government, the government then responds by doing the research that we need to do, including speaking with our statutory advisers on how we are going to respond to that amendment. And the conservation concerns put to us by Nature Scott, together with the significant concerns of the public, brought us to the view that it was an acceptable one to take forward, and that we would work with industry thereafter to form the licensing scheme.
Mr Whittaker, in his evidence to this committee, said he was unable to tell us how many mountain hares had ever been taken by birds of prey in any given year. So what was the substantive underpinning of the evidence you received from Nature Scott if he couldn't tell you how many hares were taken?
It was specifically to do with the threatened status of the mountain hare as a whole.
So it was nothing to do with, so the evidence, but I thought it was in response to a stage three amendment from a party not in government that sought to include birds of prey, falconry, in the amendment. Is that not what you just said?
The amendment wasn't specifically about falconry. The amendment was about giving protected status to mountain hares. It was about putting mountain hares on Schedule 5 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act. And that's the schedule on which sporting and recreational taking of the species is prohibited.
Right. So the circumstances when I asked a moment ago then what the circumstances were that allowed for birds of prey to be included in all of this, there weren't any.
The law doesn't specifically pick out birds of prey. It says that that the species is protected if it's on the schedule, and it can only be taken for specified purposes. And recreational or sporting
taking is not one of those purposes. So that is how birds of prey taking these species comes into this. It wasn't specifically about birds of prey. It was about putting that species on Schedule 5, making it a protected species.
Well, thank you. I think we'll consider, obviously, the evidence that we've heard this morning. I mean, I do appreciate the contribution that you've made. I think you can see the committee are quite exercised, and we'll have to consider whether we think we've had answers to the kind of questions that led us to invite you along this morning. But I'm obviously very grateful to you for the time that you've taken and for engaging as wholeheartedly as you have. Thank you all very much, and I'll suspend briefly. And welcome back to this final meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2022. And just sort of to illustrate the diverse range and nature of the petitions that we consider, we move from upland falconry to support for the taxi trade. This has been lodged petition number 1856 by Pat Rafferty on behalf of Unite. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to protect the future of the taxi trade by providing financial support to taxi drivers, setting up a national stakeholder group with trade union driver representatives, reviewing low emission standards and implementation dates. And colleagues will recall that at our last consideration of this petition, we took evidence from Callum Anderson on behalf of Unite and from Murray Fleming on behalf of the Scottish Taxi Federation. They put forward a number of proposals for improvements that could provide greater support for the taxi trade. We've subsequently received written invitation from the Scottish Taxi Federation, which provides details of the financial implications associated with becoming LEZ compliant. Now, these issues raised at our last meeting and the proposed improvements are all contained, colleagues, within our meeting papers. And I wonder if colleagues have any suggestions as to how they would like us to proceed from this point. Mr. Torrance.
Convener, I wonder if the committee could write to the Scottish Government highlighting the solutions proposed by a petitioner and the Scottish Taxi Federation and ask for them for their consideration.
Colleagues, are we content? We are. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. It might also be relevant to write to COSLA as they tend to manage the licences and also managing introduction of measures such as low emission zones, which are having a detrimental impact on the trade, and get their view on how that can be more appropriately managed or what potential remedies could come from government in terms of financial support to provide support for the transition to these compliant vehicles? Because I think there's a disconnect between the regulations being applied by local government and then the national funds that have been established to support transition. There's a bit of a disconnect there.
Okay. Are we content to... Mr Ewing?
I agree with those suggestions. When we do write to the Scottish Government, could we specifically ask if they would advise in what ways the taxi trade as a whole is brought into discussions and policy making? Because the impression I got was that the taxi trade in general feels that they're a bit of a Cinderella, and that other forms of public transport are routinely involved in every forum, every committee, every policy making body, but the taxi trade are kind of outside the room. And that particular issue is one, convener, I felt came from the evidence.
It is. I mean, I do recall the Scottish Government's response previously was to say there was no definition of public transport. Therefore, you know, they didn't, although they did say they would seek to try and engage. But I do think what we heard was that is sporadic and not structured in quite the way that it is with other forms of transport, and that something far more direct and, you know, accountable within the industry would be appropriate. So we conclude that general sentiment, yes. Okay, colleagues, and we're content. The next petition is petition number 1909, to remove the gender-based crime, domestic abuse narrative and make it gender-neutral and equal. This petition was lodged by William Wright and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to firstly make domestic abuse policies, guidance agendas and practices gender-neutral. Secondly, to introduce equal domestic abuse provision and funding for everyone in Scotland, regardless of any protected characteristic. Thirdly, to ensure all domestic abuse joint protocol guidance policies and practice for Police Scotland and Crown Office and Procure Fiscal Service are gender neutral. At our previous consideration, the committee agreed to write to the Scottish Government, Police Scotland, Mankind Initiative, the Paul Lavelle Foundation and Men's Aid Ireland. The Minister for Equalities and Older People has advised the Scottish Government is engaging and consulting on a national strategy on ending intimate and sexual violence against men and boys. She thanks the petitioner for his interest in this area of work and notes the importance of developing this strategy, which will be complementary to the equally safe strategy for women and girls. Mankind Initiative say a fully gender-informed approach should be taken to domestic abuse, and framing it as a gender-based crime leads to unequal outcomes for male and LGBT plus victims. Police Scotland state there is no variance in the current training in how to support victims of abuse and domestic abuse on the basis of gender. They outline Amos's work in Police Scotland's Domestic Abuse Forum, which informs the police's strategic direction in relation to domestic abuse. They also reiterate that the definition of domestic abuse does not distinguish victims or perpetrators on the basis of sex or gender. William, the petitioner, has provided us with further information about his own experiences as a male victim of domestic abuse. He says that statistics, including in relation to crimes committed against men, contradict views that men in Scotland have privilege, which enables them to oppress others. Now, in view of everything we've heard and the response of the government and the agencies that are now seeking to reach out and take this issue seriously, do colleagues have any reflections on how we would proceed? Mr Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. Considering all we've heard from you there just now, and that the Scottish Government is engaging and consulting on the development of a national strategy on ending intimate sexual and violence against men and boys, which will be complementing the Equal Safe strategy, and all the listed all the other evidence that we've been given, I'm quite happy to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, because I generally don't think there's anywhere that the committee could take it.
Colleagues, are we agreed that we are? And I think, obviously, we invite the petitioner just to take note of the initiatives that the Scottish Government has said that it will be progressing. And obviously, it's open to the petitioner to return if he feels that line of progression does not deliver as is hoped. And we thank the petitioner very much for his petition. The next petition is petition number 1911, Review of Human Tissue Act 2006 as it relates to post-mortems, and we are joined by a number of people directly affected and involved in the gallery this morning. This is a petition lodged by Anne Stark, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Human Tissue Scotland Act of 2006 and relevant guidance to ensure that all post-mortems can be carried out with permission of the next of kin only, do not routinely remove brains, and offer tissues and samples to next of kin as a matter of course. We've been joined this morning by Monica Lennon, MSP, who has an interest in this petition. At our last consideration of this petition, we agreed to seek additional information from a number of bodies, and responses are included in our papers. The Royal College of Pathologists has confirmed that resource concerns are not the only or main reason for its disagreement with the proposal to automatically offer tissue samples back to the next of kin. And they reiterate the challenges regarding time scales and practicalities. The Chief Coroner outlines the process of tissue retention and return in England and Wales, and include a link to guidance on CT scanning for the purposes of postmortems. Now, we've had a written submission from Anne, the petitioner. We thank her for her assiduous contributions to our deliberation. This highlights the use of body scanners as an alternative to postmortems. And additional information from Anne about their use has been summarised in the papers, colleagues, which we have received and considered. She stresses the importance of people having a choice about how their body is handled and the importance of consent. The committee has also received a number of written submissions from individuals in support of this petition and of the points raised in written evidence by the petitioner. We have Monica Lennon with us, and before I therefore open up the discussion to members of the committee, Monica, welcome once again to our proceedings, and I'd invite you, if there's anything you'd like to say in support of the petition as we consider it this morning.
Good morning, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to speak again. I'll avoid repeating points that I've made previously, but I'd like to join you, Convener, in thanking Anne and Jerry, who are in the public gallery today, and for lodging the petition and for all the work she's done to get to this point. They've raised difficult issues that many people can't even face talking about, and you'll be aware that the committee's had a number of supportive submissions from individuals who have had similar experiences. You know what the petition is seeking to do. I think in terms of the additional information that you've had since we last met, I think the information that we've had from colleagues in England, particularly in relation to the coroners, I think is really important. So we can see that there is a different approach in other parts of the UK. So we know there's that divergence, and divergence can be a good thing. But when we have families telling us that there are serious issues about consent, about proportionality, about dignity for the deceased and their families, I think we do have a duty to look at this. So I really welcome the additional work by the committee. I think the submissions received are really helpful. Personally, I still have concerns about the submission from the Royal College of Pathologists in terms of some of the resource and workforce pressures. I think they raise issues that are beyond, you know, just this petition, but I think again they merit further exploration, and I certainly would like to hear more from the Scottish Government. Just to recap, I mean, we're here because Anne and Jerry, who are the parents of Richard Stark. Richard was only 25 when he died in June of 2019, a death that was sudden and unexpected. The committee may recall that Anne had to fight, and Jerry, for a very long time to get answers. Richard's death certificate was changed roughly about 18 months after he passed away, and the cause of death was changed to a suspected seizure. But you'll also be aware that the post-mortem was very invasive, and I know it's not pleasant to hear, but you have it in your papers, details of, you know, Richard's brain, tongue, body parts being removed. Now, we've heard evidence about the use of scanners particularly in different authorities in England. And yes, there's resource implications and there's a cost to that, but we've heard about how effective these scanners can be. I'm aware the committee's had a lot of information, but last week you did get an email with a link to a video. And that's a video that was produced by professors at Leicester University. So if you've not had a chance to look at that, I think it's only 3 minutes in length, so I would refer you to look at that. In terms of the aspect of the petition around tissues and consent and the role of the next of kin, you know, it should never take a family several months to find out what has happened to their loved one after death. In this case, we're talking about 65 tissue samples, and Anne had to fight the system to have those samples returned. This is going on, and you know, people are not talking about it, often because they don't know. Anne only knew about it because she was asking questions. So I think that tells the committee there are a lot of unknowns there. This is difficult, as you can imagine, for Anne and Jerry to be sitting here today. So I don't want to add too much more, other than to say that, you know, we appreciate the work the committee has done so far. Anne has felt voiceless in this whole process. The committee has been the only forum where these issues can be brought into to the public arena. So we really welcome the work that's been done. We know that the Chief Coroner has highlighted a number of points, and there's been, I believe, an offer to connect the committee with senior coroners with experience of the scanning technology, and I think that would be certainly very worthwhile to pursue that. So I'm happy to stop there, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica, and thank you also for offering comment on behalf of the petitioners on what is a very difficult and sensitive petition. I think, having considered the evidence in this petition, it is one that we take the issues within very seriously, and is one that we want to explore further. So certainly, as convener of the committee, I in the first instance would like to suggest that we invite coroners and pathologists to give evidence, because I think I would like to understand the differences in approach between Scotland and England, and to bottom those out. Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, convener. And once we've got evidence from coroners and pathologists, I would wonder if we could invite the relevant minister to come before us and give evidence.
So we would hear from coroners and pathologists. We would subsequently seek to hear from the minister in pursuit of this petition. Are there any other suggestions colleagues would like to make, or are we content to pursue on that basis? We are. So we take the petition very seriously. We'll keep it open, and it will obviously form a significant part of our work stream as we go forward, as we now take evidence from individuals in our subsequent proceedings. So thank you very much, and I hope that meets... Well, I hope that the petitioner feels that we are taking the issue seriously as we explore the issues raised and take this now forward into an evidentiary... oral evidence. Thank you. Petition number 1928 is to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. This has been lodged by David Gallant. We heard from David and Nicoletta Primo of Sight Scotland earlier this month, and we discussed accessibility issues faced by disabled passengers using rail versus bus travel, and how an extension of the National Entitlement Card Scheme to provide free rail travel might be financed. We heard about a lack of consistency in how discounted fares for companion travel are applied in different areas, and the confusion this creates both for passengers and for rail staff. We heard of individuals boarding a train where there is a concessionary scheme in place, but getting off the train where there isn't a concessionary scheme in place and then being asked to pay for their ticket. As a result of that discussion, the committee has now written to the local authorities who offer discounted fares for companion travel to find out more about the scheme and how it operates in practice. Now, members may also be aware that the issue of free rail travel for blind and partially sighted people and their companions was the subject of a members' business debate just on the 13th of December. And during the debate, the Minister for Transport indicated that Transport Scotland have been commissioned to look into the costs of a national scheme and will be reviewing the approach to companion travel as part of the Fair Fares review. So in the light of this information, I think there are certain questions that it may present for us as a way to proceed. Would colleagues like to suggest or recommend any? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I'm wondering, considering the debate and the reassurances that we were given by the Minister, I wonder if we could write to the Scottish Government asking them if they're considering introducing a national policy for companion rail travel, and to ask them how a fair fares review will consider the free travel for companions and people who are disabilities.
I think it might be sensible for us to wait for the responses we're expecting from local authorities first, and then write on the back of that evidence. Are we content?
Yep. Yep.
Are we all content with that as the next step forward? We are. Agenda item 3 is the consideration of new petitions. We move to petition number 1965, limit estranged couples' claim on an estate after 7 years of non-medical separation, lodged by Mark MacLeod. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to limit married, informally separated, non-cohabiting couples' claim of prior right over descendants of the deceased after 7 years of separation. The Scottish Government's response states that it has carried out consultations on this matter in recent years. It notes concern with the proposals, including potential unintended consequences and difficulties in stating when any period of a formal separation actually began. It indicates the Scottish Government's intention to undertake further research on the law on intestate succession, and confirms that it will continue to keep the law of succession under review in the light of its findings. The Trusts and Succession Bill has now been lodged, and members may wish to note that Section 72 of the Bill proposes reform to the law to say that when someone dies without leaving children, the spouse or civil partner should inherit the whole estate. Under the proposals, a spouse of civil partner is defined as including the situation where the couple has separated. Members may wish to note that this petition is substantially similar, however, to petition number 1904, which we closed only as recently as March this year, on the basis that the Scottish Government indicated its intention to carry out further research on intestate succession. And at that time, the committee also noted that the legal experts, unfortunately, from the point of view of our consideration, did not support the action that was called for on the matter. I mean, in the light of that, do colleagues have any suggestions on how they would like to proceed? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, considering that the petition is substantially similar to petition 1904, which was closed in March 2022, and on the basis that the Scottish Government indicated its intentions to carry out further research into succession, I would like to consider if the committee would close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Are there any other suggestions? Could we maybe couple that with just a suggestion to the petitioner that the Trusts and Succession Scotland Bill is currently live? It's only at stage one, and it may very well be sensible to engage with that consideration. Mr. Sweeney?
Thank you, Convener. Just to inform the committee that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, as a Scottish Law Commission Bill, will be the lead committee on the consideration of that. So if the petitioner would want to engage with that committee in making any submissions for consideration as a member of that committee, I'd be happy to speak to that.
So noted, and we are agreed. So we thank the petitioner, but obviously we are closing it for the reasons involved, but understand the issues underpinning it and believe there is a forum in which those issues might yet be taken forward. Petition number 1966, which is to formally recognise and incorporate local knowledge in Scottish Government policy. This has been lodged by Helen Ferguson on behalf of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to formally recognise local knowledge and ensure that it is given full consideration alongside scientific knowledge throughout consultation, decision-making processes and in policy development, specifically in the conservation arena. UNESCO defines local knowledge as the understandings, skills and philosophies developed by societies with long histories of interaction with their natural surroundings. For rural and indigenous peoples, local knowledge informs decision-making about fundamental aspects of day-to-day life. Now, Helen argues that local knowledge is often considered inferior to scientific knowledge, and that the conservation arena is dominated by academia and the scientific elite, distanced from the practical daily routine and rural reality of rural practitioners. Helen also suggests that the board and leadership of Nature Scot has little representation from individuals experienced in day-to-day land or water management. She also raises concerns about accessibility issues in relation to poor broadband connection in rural areas, leading to challenges when engagement is something that they would wish to pursue. The Scottish Government's response to the petition sets out its co-design approach to developing a new Scottish biodiversity strategy and its delivery plan and its work on consulting with the public on proposed legislation. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's imperative that we write to the Scottish Government to ask its view on whether there are differences in the considerations given to local knowledge and scientific knowledge, as the petitioner has indicated, how it ensures those with poor internet access, particularly in rural areas, are given the opportunity to respond to the public consultation, and what changes it is in the practices, including the development of the delivery of conservation policy, does it intend to make following the representation in the report of the independent working group.
Mr. Torrance.
I just wonder if we could add that to write to Nature Scot seeking details on the membership and skills of its board, Convener.
How very apposite.
It is, considering what we just previously had this morning.
After our deliberations this morning. Mr. Ewing.
We asked Nature Scot when they're going to invite somebody from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association to join their board, because it does seem to me to be strange that we have a group representing the people who actually work day and daily in the land. They're not sitting clattering keyboard warriors. They're actually managing nature, looking after animals for which they care deeply, and yet they're completely unrepresented, as far as I understand, in Nature Scot. So they're denied the opportunity of that centuries of experience of people who care deeply for the countryside and the animals in Scotland.
I think we're agreed that we will ask that question as well. Thank you all very much. Petition number 1967, protect Loch Lomond's Atlantic Oakwood shoreline by implementing the high road option for the A82 upgrade between Tarbert and Inverarum. This petition to protect Loch Lomond's Atlantic Oakwood shoreline has been lodged by John Urquhart on behalf of Helensburgh and District Access Trust and the Friends of Loch Lomond and the Trossachs. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reconsider the process for selecting the preferred option for the planned upgrade of the A82 between Tarbert and Inverarum, and replace the Design Manual for Roads and Bridges, the DMRB-based assessment, with the more comprehensive Scottish Transport appraisal guidance. Delighted to say we've been joined this morning by Jackie Bailey, MSP, back to our proceedings on another nature-related petition, as it happens.
Absolutely. Can I make clear, Convener, I'm nothing to do with Nature Scot. Right? If that pleases the committee.
Well, on that basis alone, we welcome you, Jackie, to our proceedings this morning. The petitioners tell us they've engaged in a campaign to inform officials, politicians and the wider public about the issues posed by the proposal to upgrade the A82 between Tarbert and Inverarum, and have highlighted what they view as the advantages of pursuing the high road option. In response to the petition, Transport Scotland have outlined the process that was undertaken to assess the options and to identify their preferred option to improve road standards in the A82. Transport Scotland consider the approach they have taken was rational and proportionate, and have confirmed that detailed development and assessment of the preferred route option is ongoing. The petitioners have responded to the information provided by Transport Scotland, highlighting concerns that the route analysis that was undertaken appears not to have followed the STAG assessment framework and has ignored costs associated with delays and diversions during construction, maintenance and after serious accidents. The petitioners also note the approaches that have been taken to other road infrastructure projects, such as the M74 extension in Glasgow and the A9 upgrade at Killiecrankie, as positive examples where the economic and environmental impacts were more fully explored during the appraisal process. And before we open this up for discussion, can I ask Jackie Bailey if she would like to contribute her thoughts in support of the petition?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to the members for allowing me to speak. I'm joined by the petitioners in the public gallery today, so I'm sure if I get anything wrong, they'll be passing me notes. But at the heart of this, as you've rightly pointed out, is the replacement of the A82 between Inverannan and Tarbert, much of which runs through my constituency. The problem, as you've quite rightly highlighted, is the design was undertaken using the design manual for roads and bridges rather than the more formal and more comprehensive STAG process which we are all used to. The context, I think, is important because this will be the key capital expenditure within the national park. It's probably the biggest project of its kind and most significant. And the Access Trust have, over the years, worked with the National Park in developing paths and walkways right throughout some of our most iconic countryside. They've developed, for example, the Three Lochs Way, which runs from Balloch to Inverruglas, and it's one of the great Scottish trails. The hope, of course, is that we might be able to join it up with Ardlui and create, if you like, a round the loch trail. So the potential here is enormous. But I don't need to remind any of you, I'm sure you've all visited Loch Lomond, of the heritage, the outstanding environment. It is, I believe, the most beautiful part of Scotland, but I am biased. Considering an alternative option, rather than just pushing ahead with the existing road, is something that Transport Scotland simply have ignored to the extent that we think is possible. So if you adopted a high road option rather than the existing route, you would protect oak woods, you would preserve the shoreline, you would have a walking and cycling route with the old road, you would be able to have people access that northern part by foot and see some of the forest that and the woodland that is actually on the shoreline. We would have a great walking trail. The road safety issues at Arica Primary School would be resolved, and you would get a faster, more direct route. All of these benefits seem to have been ignored by the appraisal process. Now, let me say to you, I think that's a real opportunity, but when you look closer at this, between the shoreline route, the existing route, and the high route, it looks as if the appraisal was not done in an unbiased manner. So, for example, not that I would know this, Convener, but I'm sure you do, that three tunnels were proposed. No, they were costed for. No tunnels actually are required or appeared on the diagrams and the plans. The tunnels were costed at 90 million per kilometre. The three tunnels that don't exist, 90 million per kilometre, whereas in fact PwC estimated at 30 million per kilometre. It looks as if somebody was trying to stack the consideration, I hesitate to say this, in favour of the alternative route, against the alternative route, so that they could stick to their engineering plans as they stood. That inflated the cost by 146.55 million. It is unrealistic to suggest that these costs match in some way. There was insufficient consultation with the local community. The groups behind the petition, including Friends of Loch Lomond, were not consulted, and they've had to dig away to find out that information. We have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to get this right. I understand the frustration of engineers that just want to get on and build the road and build it on its current configurations. That would cause traffic chaos, I have to say, and the opportunity for a new route absolutely needs to be grabbed. Can I, because I know the committee like to get out of Holyrood, invite you to all visit? We'll walk you around the route and the potential options that are there. But you might want to also consider taking evidence from Transport Scotland, from the National Park, who have a significant say in this, and indeed from the Minister, because our judgment is there's been no political oversight of this. We have an opportunity to do the right thing, and actually, if the committee suggested a stag appraisal, we're confident that the high road would emerge as the preferred option. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Jackie Bailey, and outlining circumstances that are familiar to us, I think, in our consideration of petitions on many and diverse issues. Colleagues, I mean, I think we have a bit of work ahead of us in relation to this petition, and some of the suggestions Ms. Bailey has made may even figure at another stage as we go along the route. And it may even be that we do come and visit. I mean, there's no election campaign in the immediate future ahead that we could be coming to to participate in, but it probably would be quite useful at some stage to have a look. So I'm going to ask colleagues how they think at this stage we might take things forward. Mr. Sweeney?
Yeah, I support the proposal for us to do further inquiry into this matter. It's a broader national consideration as well, because certainly from representations I've had previously from Rail Future Scotland, there is a deep concern that Transport Scotland is attitudinally predisposed to heavily over-engineering solutions for road building, trunk road building, and have an attitudinal dislike towards rail development, for example. So they will overly analyse and put very onerous requirements on rail programmes, but will, you know, do kind of very elaborate schemes for trunk road construction. I think there is a general consideration about how transparent Transport Scotland actually are in developing these projects. So I think there's a broader national consideration here about policy and how accountable that agency are. And in this particular instance, I think there is a deep concern about the coastal route along the Loch Lomond side being damaged. I'm mindful of Sir Robert Grieve, one of the masterminds of the National Park Project, with Tom Weir back in the 1970s, talking about it didn't want it to end up like the Italian lakes built from end to end. And this seems like it's a real travesty if this were to go ahead and destroy the spirit in which the National Park was created.
You're younger than you look, Mr. Sweeney.
I'm just a fan of Weir's Way, that's all. Yeah.
Was there a proposal for us in there, Mr. Sweeney? I mean, I know you're in support of the petition.
I think we should go forward with a proposal. We should invite Transport Scotland to make representations about the process in which they have followed. We might also want to pursue the site visit.
Ask for the stag assessment, perhaps, from Transport Scotland.
Yes.
Any other? Mr. Torrance?
I wonder if we could write to Argyll and Bute Council to get their views on it, and the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park, to see their views on what's planned for A92.
OK, so that's writing to Transport Scotland on the issues that we've identified, writing to Argyll and Bute Council and the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park as well. Any other suggestions? Mr. Ewing?
Yeah, it was just two points. I think Jackie Bailey referred to, I think it was a PwC report as to the cost of the tunnels, and I was just looking at amongst the papers to see if there was a specific reference to this, and perhaps there is, and I've missed it, but I'd be keen to get more details, perhaps copies of these documents, in order to look into the points that Ms. Bailey made about the relative costings, which I think we need to look at quite carefully. And secondly, I know from formerly representing Lough Aber, rather long time ago now, when Mr. Sweeney was even younger than he is currently, but also that people living in the kind of Oban Argyll area are also served by the A82, and I know that there is a huge support for upgrading of the A82 along Loch Lomond side, and that has been the case for, sadly, many decades. So I wonder if we might just reach out in fairness to the community, perhaps the Chamber of Commerce. I know some of the individuals who were involved in Lough Aber and Argyll, because they do have very strong views about the importance of proceeding with upgrading of this road.
Yeah, and I think I saw some engagement with the gallery, so I suspect the petitioners will be able to assist us on one or two of these issues if the clerks wish to liaise further with them. So I think we're very interested in taking the issues of this petition forward, and I think that's a fairly comprehensive range of agencies and individuals from whom we'll seek further evidence that we can consider in due course. Are we content? We are. Thank you very much. And thank you very much, Jackie Bailey. And thank you again to our petitioners who have joined us this morning. Petition number 1970 to create an online account for parents to manage the 1,140 hours of early learning and childcare funding. This next petition comes from Sharon Fairley on behalf of the Scottish Private Nursery Association and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reform the funding model of the 1140 hours of early years learning and childcare to allow parents direct control of childcare funding via an online account. The Spice briefing highlights the funding follows the child approach, which is intended to be provider neutral, allowing families to choose their preferred ELC setting. It notes that submissions to the Education, Children and Young People Committee argued that some PVI providers' funding from local authorities was not meeting full costs of the place. The Scottish Government consulted on the delivery of ELC and received some support from ELC accounts, but note the limitations were a lack of certainty for private providers and local authorities and risk of parents using funds for other things. The submission also notes the investment and time required to deliver a new system. Now, the National Day Nurseries Association have written to the committee, stating their support for the action called for in the petition. They highlight discrepancies in funding between local authority, ELC and other providers, and argue that a childcare passport would provide choice, flexibility and affordability for parents. They note that it is difficult for local authorities to be both funder and provider. Colleagues, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Stewart.
I think that there are many merits in this petition, convener, and I think it's important that we write to stakeholders seeking their views on action called within the petition. And they may include COSLA, the Early Years Scotland, the National Child Minding Association and National Parents Forum Scotland. I think all of those could give us a good indication as to what the views are with reference to this petition.
Colleagues content? Yep. We are. Petition number 1971 to take robust action to stop motorcycle theft, lodged by Kenneth Clayton on behalf of the Motorcycle Action Group, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the actions available to help prevent and reduce motorcycle theft by, firstly, empowering police to pursue and tactically engage thieves, and secondly, reviewing sentencing policy to allow the courts to implement tougher punishment for those convicted of motorcycle theft, including the use of mandatory custodial sentences for those carrying weapons or groups who threaten individuals with violence. Kenneth tells us that there has been an increase in the number of motorcycles being stolen in cities, with Edinburgh being particularly affected. He goes on to highlight concerns that the current police policy not to pursue or engage means thieves behave with impunity, a position that is out of sync with other police forces across the UK. Now, the Spice briefing notes that Police Scotland have taken targeted action to tackle motorcycle theft and associated antisocial behaviour in Edinburgh through Operation Soteria. This action saw police recover £600,000 worth of stolen motorbikes. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government state that there are a wide range of effective actions available to Police Scotland to prevent and reduce motorcycle theft, as the use of these actions would be an operational matter. The Scottish Government has indicated that we may wish to explore these further with the Chief Constable or the Scottish Police Authority. In relation to the petition's call for mandatory custodial sentences, the Scottish Government has indicated that judges are best placed to decide on the appropriate sentence for each offender. The Scottish Government also note that the Scottish Parliament has previously rejected calls for mandatory sentencing on the basis that it removes discretion from the court. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action on this petition? I think we could do with some clarification in the first instance, yes. Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would like to write to Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority to ask how many incidents of motorcycle theft is recorded in each of the past 5 years and what further action they are taking to tackle motorcycle theft now that the Operation Solitaria has concluded and whether they have plans to roll out similar initiatives across the rest of Scotland.
Any other suggestions, colleagues? Mr. Stewart?
I think it would be quite useful also to write to the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service to seek information on the number of cases related to motorcycle theft that has occurred in each over the last 5 years and the outcomes that have come from cases that have been. I think that would be useful too, Convener.
Are we content with those proposals? We are. Petition number 1972 to allow assisted dying for people with long-term mental illness and consent incapacity, lodged by Kevin Sutherland, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure all future legislation on assisted dying includes provisions for access to assisted dying for anyone of adult age suffering from a long-term mental illness and or who has compelling philosophical reasons for wanting to terminate their lives, provided that they have sought psychological psychiatric assistance which resulted in no change to their condition, and continue to have consenting capacity. Kevin tells us that the mental suffering people endure can be just as torturous and painful as any physical condition, and in the event that assisted dying is made legal in Scotland, people with incurable mental health issues should be able to make the case to end their lives. Kevin also tells us that many people travel abroad to end their lives in a controlled environment, an option he intends to take, but is concerned for those who do not have the resources to undertake such a journey and who he feels are being left to suffer in silence. Now, members will obviously be aware that Liam MacArthur, MSP, has now earned the right to introduce his proposed assisted dying for terminally ill adults Scotland bill. As the Spice briefing notes, while the bill is currently limited by what was included in the final proposal, other members could bring forward amendments at stages 2 and 3, seeking to alter the scope of the bill. In their response to the petition, the Scottish Government has indicated that it would not support any legislation or amendment with regards to allowing assisted dying for people with long-term mental illness and consenting capacity. So it would be very opposed to that. Do members have any comments or suggestions? I'm tempted, given that Liam MacArthur does have a private members bill proceeding in a members bill proceeding on this issue under Rule 15.7, to suggest that, important as the issues are that are raised within it, I don't think it would be right for this committee to set up a parallel inquiry investigation when there is a bill before Parliament that appears to have the ability to proceed and to potentially be considered by committee in due course. And in any event, the Scottish Government, in respect of this particular amendment, have said they would have no, of this petition, have said that they would most certainly not support any legislation in this regard. But I think that would be an issue in due course for that might be considered when the bill was progressing through its stages in Parliament. So I don't know whether other colleagues are minded to agree with that proposal. Mr. Torrance?
Yeah, I'm happy to agree with it. Somebody who supports Liam MacArthur's bill in Parliament, if anybody wants to take any amendments at stage 1, 2 or 3 and to test the government, they can do. So I'm quite happy to close the petition under Rule 15.
And I should declare as a supporter of Mr. MacArthur's bill in principle as well. I'm making that suggestion. Mr. Sweeney?
Yeah, I agree with the proposal to close, but would, in closing, advise the petitioner of the methods in which they can engage with the legislative process.
Yeah. I think we can. Okay, and we thank the petitioner for the issues that he has raised. Petition number 1973 to end the use of sheriff's discretion when ruling on civil cases and provide clear guidance, legal guidance on division of assets. This has been lodged by Sandy Isett and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Family Law Scotland Act of 2006 and provide greater clarity on the division of assets in cases of cohabiting couples who are separating by removing the use of sheriff's discretion rulings in civil cases, providing clear legal guidance to the Law Society of Scotland on the division of assets for cohabiting couples, allowing appeals to be heard where it is determined that a sheriff has the rule of law wrong but have used their discretion to prevent an appeal at no cost to the appellant, and publishing information on what resources have been allocated to provide clear legal guidance. Sandy Isett tells us that a lack of clarity in the law regarding the division of assets for cohabiting couples has resulted in cases proceeding to court and taking up valuable court time. He suggests that the provision of clear legal guidance would offer clarity on this issue and enable ministers to be resolved without the need for a court hearing. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government states that the Family Law Scotland Act of 2006 introduced legal protections for cohabiting couples should their relationship come to an end by separation or death. The Scottish Government also highlights that the Scottish Law Commission are carrying out a review of aspects of family law. Following the Scottish Government response, members may be aware that the Scottish Law Commission has now published its report and draft bill on cohabitation. We have also received a written submission from Mr. Isaac, who raises concerns that where the division of assets have not been clearly defined in law, there is too much room for argument by competing solicitors, leaving sheriffs with discretion to rule on how they feel rather than what is fair, true and just. Interesting. Do colleagues have any suggestions, Mr. Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I think further information is required and we continue with this petition. So I would suggest that we write to the Scottish Government to seek its response to the recommendations proposed by the Scottish Law Commission in their report on cohabitation and the timetable for bringing forward legislation in the area. To write to the Scottish Law Commission to seek information on what consideration has been given to the use of judicial discretion as part of the review of aspects of family law, and also to write to the Law Society of Scotland and the Family Law Association to seek their views on the issues raised by the petitioner. I think all of those require some merit, Convener.
Any other suggestions from colleagues? Are we content to proceed on that basis? We are, and that then concludes agenda item 3, consideration of new petitions, and we move into private session to consider item 4. As noted in the agenda, the committee will then move back into public session in approximately 20 minutes to hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on our final petition. And although that is not our normal practice, we have agreed to that in order to facilitate our ministerial guests giving evidence this morning. So I now move into private session. And good morning and welcome back to this final session of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2022. We were hearing consideration of new petitions prior to our short suspension. And we now move to agenda item 5, which is consideration of a continuing petition. This is petition number 1871, the full review of mental health services, lodged by Karen McCowan on behalf of Shining Lights for Change. This petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to carry out a full review of mental health services in Scotland to include the referral process, crisis support, risk assessments, safe plans, integrated services working together, first response support and the support available to families affected by suicide. Now, the committee will recall that we heard a very affecting testimony from Karen about the personal circumstances that led to this petition. And also the changes she wishes to see in the mental health, to mental health services. And we'd like to obviously thank Karen again for raising this petition and also for taking the time to meet with us ahead of our session. Now, we are joined this morning by Hamza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. Good morning. To Hugh McAloon, Director of Mental Health. To Gavin Gray, Deputy Director, Improving Mental Health Services. And Dr. Alistair Cook, the Principal Medical Officer. And thank you all very much for joining us and for giving evidence to us this morning. And we're also joined this morning in support of the petition by Monica Lennon, MSP, who I will invite to make a contribution subsequent to our hearing the Minister's evidence. Now, we're quite happy to move to questions, but I'm also quite happy if there's anything you'd like to say to us, Minister, Cabinet Secretary, before we begin.
Just briefly, if I may,
please do.
Convener, I certainly won't take up too much time at all in my opening remarks, and I'm keen to hear from members and take questions and allow as much time for that as possible. But I did want to start by first and foremost reiterating what you have said, Convener. I read the testimony of Ms. McCune and Karen's testimony in particular. It was very, very moving indeed, and I want to offer my sincerest condolences to her for the sad passing of her partner. And I think the passion to which she's brought this issue is a fitting testimony and tribute to her late partner, Luke. And again, I'm very grateful to her for coming to this committee. I hope it is clear that what the petitioner wants and what the Scottish Government wants actually in terms of outcomes is the same. We may not necessarily absolutely agree in how we get to those outcomes, but certainly the outcomes are the same. And I suspect that is for everybody around this table. We want a mental health system where, first of all, we can intervene as early as possible before it gets to that crisis intervention, but where you don't have to repeatedly tell your story. And that was something that we heard from Ms. McCoon very, very clearly over and over and over again when Luke asked for help, I think 8 times, in fact, before he got the support that he requires. So we want a responsive system within which all partners work together at every single level of need. That should apply to signposting, to help, to advice, access to support in our communities, providing the right support for those in distress, and importantly delivering where necessary and critical that specialist mental health support and services. So our forthcoming mental health and wellbeing strategy will be key to setting out not just those aspirations but how we achieve those aspirations, and we'll publish that strategy in spring of next year in 2023 and it will set out what any member of the public is rightly entitled to expect when they ask for help in relation to their mental health. And I want our strategy to act as a blueprint for a high-functioning mental health system. That will be in terms of how we respond to all levels of need, and we expect to see the system, as I say, acting responsibly. Nobody should have to struggle in the way that, frankly, Luke had to struggle in order to fight for the help that they need. And the earlier we can get people to the right support, then, of course, the better chances we have for better outcomes and stopping those issues from escalating. So at the heart of that work, and especially our new strategy, it must be the focus on reducing stigma, on prevention, including, of course, suicide prevention, and involving the voices of lived experience at every single level. And I think that's came very, very strongly from the petitioner, from Karen, and clearly resonated with so many people. So obviously I'll get into the finer detail of that, convener, but happy to leave it to there and to end where I started, which is to recognise the passion, drivery, drive and bravery of Karen, and commend her for what is a fundamentally important petition.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and can I thank you for the sympathies and comments you've expressed in relation to the petitioner. It was difficult to read. It was equally difficult, obviously, to hear the real-time experience of the petitioner, and I know that those sentiments that you've expressed are shared by us all. Perhaps you will indicate, as we proceed, when you would potentially like to include your colleagues this morning in response to any of the questions. I'll leave it to your discretion. Or should any of them, at any point, with any of my colleagues, when they're asking, have a wish to intervene, please do so. We try to keep it relatively informal as we go through proceedings in order to have as productive a discussion as we possibly can. Can I just ask an introductory question? And I suppose I'm intrigued to know, Cabinet Secretary, why you what you think the factors were that are responsible for, it seems, the fall in the number of suicides we saw during the pandemic.
I think it would be one that I'll perhaps hand over to clinical colleagues and others around the table. We've certainly had that discussion. I think it's very, very difficult to say, given that we're still not quite out that pandemic. So it's challenging. I mean, one of the really concerns that I've had through mental health, so I'll come back to suicide and the suicide prevention in a minute. One of the key concerns clearly I had, and I think every member on this table had, was the access or lack of access to services during the pandemic. We've obviously put a lot of work into suicide prevention, and during the pandemic, even at the most difficult times in that pandemic, when we were under significant legal restriction, we still try to ensure that vital services, and I include suicide prevention within that, include mental health services within that, we try to make sure that they were still as accessible as they possibly were. But of course, suicide prevention has been a mission of this government's for many, many years, and we're beginning to see, we've seen some positive signs in the right direction if you look at recent trends. But I have to say, we are nowhere near where we want to be, hence why we have the suicide prevention strategy that was co-designed with COSLA. But I don't know, Alistair, if, in particular, if you want to just come in. Or
I mean, I think initially in the academics, and we have an academic group that supports the work of the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group, I think there was initially a little bit of surprise that the direction things went, because the expectation was that given the difficulties of lockdown, etc., and some of the figures that we're seeing around increased suicidal thoughts, etc., within the population, that we might see a rise. But actually, internationally, there appears to have been a decrease across. So at this stage, I think we're theorising rather than understanding why that would be the case. But It certainly over historical patterns of suicide rates, it tends to be at times of greater disparity within populations that you see increases in suicide. So perhaps that sense of coming together that there was around the pandemic had some impact on some people. But again, it's theorising rather than anything based in research or academia at this stage.
One of the other theories, as Alistair is right to describe it, was, and I think all of us could probably testify to this, at the early days of the pandemic and right throughout those really difficult periods, we saw a real groundswell of local activity in relation to third sector support and help. And that still exists to an extent, but certainly I remember at the beginning of the pandemic how that just sprung organically, as a groundswell. And therefore, people might have actually had access to those services in a way that actually now, as people are getting on with the jobs that they normally have done, perhaps doesn't exist as much. So that's, again, one of the, I know, the discussions that we'd had to.
I mean, it was certainly part of the initial questioning in Parliament, where things like domestic abuse, suicide, all of these were issues that people were concerned that the prolonged lockdown might have had, and in some cases did have a negative impact on. But as you say, theorising only at the moment, but perhaps it was the fact that people's experience was not so different or isolating in that sense, that they were part of an experience that really everybody else was sharing too, and so that made maybe some of those things easier to bear or to deal with in those circumstances. That's interesting. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. And I note the comments made so far about trying to sort of understand the reasoning and the causal factors behind all this. But nonetheless, the 2018 Suicide Prevention Action Plan did set a target of a 20% reduction by this year. And although we haven't got the figures for this year, we can see the broad trend across that average. Unlikely to see, or I won't see the target being met. I just wonder whether the Cabinet Secretary could explain what the reasons are why that wouldn't be met now.
Well, again, you're right, Steve, we need to wait for the figures, but I'm not disagreeing with your assumptions around that. And look, we'll always set really ambitious targets to stretch ourselves to make sure we are going as far as we possibly think we can. What I would do is commend the most recent strategy in conjunction with COS. I'm certain Paul Sweeney will have seen it and certainly skimmed through it, if nothing else. But creating hope together, that long-term suicide prevention strategy and action plan looks at the trends that we've seen over the last number of years and says, well, actually, how do we improve? And we have a goal in there, of course, to reduce the number of deaths, suicide deaths in Scotland. While importantly, and this was why we were so keen to do the strategy alongside COSLA, is to tackle the inequalities, as Dr. Cook's already mentioned, you know, tackle those inequalities which contribute to suicide. So I think, we have not managed to go as far as we've wanted to in terms of the reduction in suicide deaths. We've seen positive progress. New strategy takes into account the good that we were doing, where we need to go further, how we work with local partners, but importantly, reduce inequalities further, because we know the disparity in inequalities, without a shadow of a doubt, is a disproportionate factor when it comes to deaths by suicide.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I can accept that there isn't everything in the gift of government to preserve life in all circumstances, quite obviously, but nonetheless, there are areas where the government can have a positive influence in trying to ameliorate these effects and towards that target. So to that end, what assessment has there been of work streams or activities within the plan that have been assessed against performance, and where are areas showing promise, where are areas showing difficulty? It would just be interesting to get a bit more of an insight as to where you see the greatest impact being achieved in terms of the plan and areas which are harder to deliver.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So in a few areas, so I think as you'll see from the most recent strategy, as I say, co-designed with COSLA, there is a significant focus on the social determinants of suicide and tackling those, because again, there is literature upon literature, academic research after academic research, which makes that link between those social determinants, the inequality that exists, and unfortunately, the completion of suicide. So we are working exceptionally hard. Where I think we can do more is certainly in that work stream. I'm also, you'll also see through the strategy that there is a lot of work on as much pre-crisis intervention. So getting to people before it is escalated into really specialist mental health challenges. In terms of the assessment I've made, I may be better taking that one off table and getting to you in more writing and more detail around each of the work streams that are involved and the assessments that have been made. But certainly, as I say, the most recent strategy that has been published, Creating Hope, together, that gives a good indication, I think, if you get a chance to look through it in detail, what we think has worked and where we think collaboratively with local partners we need to go further. But I don't know whether Hugh in particular on this front or others might wish to come in to add to what I've said, because I know how involved you were in the strategy with COSLA.
I mean, I think the whole kind of area of targets, I think the thinking's moved on since the last strategy, and you'll see that there's not a specific target. I think there was a few reasons for that, and it really led by stakeholders. So stakeholders were heavily involved in the development of the new strategy. So their view was that the complexity of suicide is such that, you know, actually just looking at headline numbers can be quite a crude measure. It can be, you know, all in all, you know, setting a target might indicate to some who do lose loved ones through suicide that if you're below that target, it matters less, and of course it doesn't. And then thirdly, when you get to a local level, population sizes vary so much that when you actually get down to that level, you'll kind of have a bit more variation within the numbers. So there's some technical reasons, but there's some really kind of important reasons that relate to, I guess, the people left behind and how that feels. So the view very much from the group was that, of course, we should continue to monitor the overall headline figures, but have that amongst a range of other outcomes. So that's kind of the direction that the group took it in. As the CAPSEC says, we can come back on evaluation against the work streams from the previous strategy. If you'd find that helpful, we can write back in with that.
That would be, yes, sorry.
One of the areas where I think we're making real progress is around the response to suicidal ideas and people coming in crisis, and the work that's happening at what, so headlined time, space, compassion, and a new approach to that. And that really chimes both with what we've heard from stakeholders and those with lived experience, and I think is hugely welcomed by the clinical community as well, in that sense of just trying to take that different approach, which is perhaps less binary. The approach maybe in the past would have been, are you ill or needing a secondary mental health service? Yeah. I think that the time, space, compassion acknowledges that people are there because they're in distress or they have reasons, and that we need to have a range of different responses. And that's the direction that the new strategy, both in terms of suicide prevention and the mental health strategy, will take us.
That is quite promising. If there are signs where the crisis element of it can be practically addressed in a more holistic way, I know certainly from experience with dealing with veterans, for example, it was just getting passed around with seeming no one taking ownership of the situation that led people to a situation of despair where they completed suicide. So that does sound promising. Whilst I accept that, you know, even something like the increase in interest rates could increase suicide because of its consequent financial pressures, for example, and that's not necessarily something that's in the gift of a government policy necessarily, but
general direction. Sorry to interrupt, but yeah, the general direction of our policy around mental health. I think, you know, there will always be people who experience mental illness, and they deserve a high quality clinical response to that. What I think we see more and more is people who, for any number of reasons, and look what we've been through in the last few years. And look what we're going through now, and what people out there are going through in terms of cost of living crisis. But there's a whole range of factors that can really ramp up emotional distress. So from a very clinical point of view, you might think that someone has not got any particular mental illness, but they're probably at risk of suicide or suicidal ideas, because they're really distressed because of the factors that are impacting on their well-being at any point in time. And that can come and go. So a lot of our focus has been around what can we do to respond when people experience emotional distress. So things like distress brief interventions, which has been getting developed for a number of years, and access to the mental, the NHS 24 mental health hub. These are things that people can go to because sometimes you can't wait for an appointment, and sometimes the key point is in that very contained period of time, which, you know, we see from this petition an example of that, where somebody over the course of, I think it was about a week, was experiencing really serious distress, which may not have been based on anything clinical, but tragically we see where that can lead. So I think it's having a balance across that, and so that's true of a wider range of things than risk of suicide, but I think it obviously is most heightened at that stage. But you just want to kind of have interventions that just help people manage that distress better.
If I may, Convener, can I ask a brief supplementary just on how this is interacting with the National Mission on Drugs in particular? Because obviously the thing I've discovered, certainly from personal experience, is it's not necessarily intentional completion of suicide, but there's almost an indifference to being alive in some instances where it's ambivalence, and there's a reckless behaviour that then is characterised by that. And obviously, when there's a request to get treatment or a request to get support, it's not often forthcoming. Other referred to a mental health service that's maybe weeks away. I just wondered if there is an interaction with the National Mission on Drugs and how that...
Absolutely. Angela Constance and I obviously will meet and talk regularly about this, and I should have said from the offset, I'm actually really grateful to Paul Sweeney for speaking about his own mental health, as he has done, I know in the past, and other members have done so, and I think it's actually important for us. It's not incumbent, you don't have to do it, we don't necessarily owe people that, but I think actually the platforms that we carry, the more and more we can talk about it, the more we can hopefully reduce some of the stigma around mental health, and I'm grateful for all members that have done that. So MAT Standard 9 is really key to this. MAT Standard 9, of course, is that expectation expectation that all people with co-occurring drug use and mental health difficulties receive mental health care at the point of the MAT delivery, the medical assisted treatment delivery. So some local authorities in some areas, of course, as always, doing better than others, but what we've asked all local authorities to do is now submit that implementation plan to Scottish Government, sets out how they're going to embed all 10 standards right across the piece in their area. We are monitoring that, as you can imagine, very regularly. Certainly I'm doing it on a monthly or where necessary on a quarterly basis. Local authorities are doing well in that regard. They'll have less monitoring and supervision, but certainly those local authorities where we're seeing that MAT standard, all MAT standards, but particularly MAT standard 9 is relevant to your question, monitoring that very, very regularly. You can imagine having conversations in that respect, and obviously it's also backed by multi-year commitment to funding as well. Thanks.
Thank you very much. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In evidence to the committee, the petitioner stressed that measuring and evaluating the performance of plans and strategies are crucial. When will the outcome framework for a new suicide prevention action plan be published? And can the Cabinet Secretary tell the committee more about work taking place to develop the outcomes of a framework and how it will be used?
Yeah, so if I can address the issue with the general, then I'll come back to the specific, if I may. So in the general, it's been my view since I've come into post that although we have a lot of real suite, actually, of quality standards when it comes to measure and monitor the outcomes for child and adolescent mental health, we don't have similar for adult mental health services, and that's a gap. So there's some work that's ongoing at the moment to develop that suite of quality standards to improve the quality and safety of mental health care and support, and that definitely includes adult secondary mental health service standards and the delivery of psychological therapies, interventions, looking at eating disorder standards and so on and so forth. So there's a whole range of work going on. On the specifics, Hugh might have the specifics of when the date or what our intentions are in relation to the outcomes framework, but certainly because we're co-designing or have co-designed the strategy with COSLA, obviously we're trying to ensure anything we do in that space is done collaboratively with COSLA and local authorities. But I don't know if you've got the specifics on.
I've got a specific date, but we can come back to you on more specific information. But I think we're looking at just as we develop and roll out the delivery plan alongside the strategy, that there will be just regular evaluation and monitoring and review against those outcomes. So there's kind of programme of work there, but again, we can provide some more detail. I'm sorry, I haven't got specifics around dates.
The Scottish Mental Health Review report was published in September 2022 and made more than 200 recommendations. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on when we expect the government's response to the report?
Yeah, I can come in. As you're aware, it's a wide-ranging, extensive, very detailed report. I think it runs to about 1,000 pages. We're currently starting work with a range of stakeholders to assess that in terms of the order we might do things in, the further work we might have to do in some areas, and the priority that we would attach to various steps in what is going to be a long-term programme of work to align mental health law with equality and human rights law. Our intention would be to come forward probably before summer recess with our initial response to that. And as I say, we are working with a range of stakeholders, some of whom were involved in the review itself. Partly that's to kind of fully understand how they saw it being taken forward and how they saw the various aspects linking together. So there's a lot of complexity in there, but we're looking to come forward with something before summer recess.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Can I touch on access? Now, we're aware that the Scottish Government set the standard to be 90%. Of individuals being referred within the 18 weeks. And we know at the moment that's not being achieved. I think the most recent statistics were September 2022, and we were looking at 80.7. So can I ask the Scottish Government, when do they see the opportunity of reaching that 90%? And what's it doing to support that aspiration?
So we obviously publicly have said we're attempting to reach that target by March 2023. I do think that will be challenging. It's ambitious, again, going back to my point to a previous member. We'll set ourselves those ambitious targets to try to push the entire system to help us to meet it. Again, there's a common theme, I know, but there are some health boards where I'm very confident that they'll make it. And there's other health boards, including one of the health boards that the member has raised with me regularly, where I think it will be very unlikely that they will achieve it. So we're giving them more intense support, getting from them an improvement plan, not accepting the fact that, well, you're not going to make it by March 23, but certainly saying, well, OK, how do we help you to get there or get as close to there as possible? I mean, there's a myriad of challenges. He'll know well, as I know he does, that... Excuse me, although we have done well in terms of workforce recruitment, that will be different in rural areas and urban areas and island communities and so on and so forth. So we have that target around spring next year. It will be challenging, but I'm committed to try to do everything we can to get us there.
And, you know, you've touched on the population issues. Now, we know that NHS boards that have a larger population, you know, they have set themselves and do have the mental health assessment units that are there 24/7. And that is really useful for the larger populations. But it's trying to evaluate these, Cabinet Secretary, and are the Scottish Government looking to make that much more of a national service to ensure that's the case? And you've already touched on the rural. Now, that is... as you've already identified, a much, much bigger challenge for you to try and make that happen. But there is a disparity between what then does happen in the urban area in comparison to the rural, that don't have the same support, that don't have the same opportunities, and patients may well then potentially fall through the gap.
So, I mean, Alexander Stewart understands as well that you know, urban areas will have their own challenges. Large population centres will have their own challenges. Areas of urban areas will often have areas of higher deprivation and large concentration. And therefore, we've already talked about those social determinants, which can have more negative outcomes in terms of people's health, both physical and mental health. So urban areas will have their own challenges. Remote, rural and island communities will have their own challenges, usually centred in around, well, first access to service, as you're quite rightly to say, but also, of course, workforce, which is not unrelated to that point, and recruitment and retention of workforce. I should say the NHS 24, obviously, as the committee is aware of, have their mental health hub. There were some challenges, I think, when it first started, but certainly we've seen some improvements right across all of the metrics. In 2021, that demand for that NHS 24 mental health hub has remained consistently high. I was speaking to the chief executive just a couple of weeks ago, and really since July 2020, they've not seen much of a dip. There've been peaks and troughs, as you'd imagine, but you know, generally quite consistently high, over 2,500 calls per week, and it's responded thus far to over 200,000. Calls. We'll continue to invest in local services in remote and rural areas and island communities. What I'm particularly keen to try to do is, as well as obviously the important statutory services, making sure people have access to them, quite keen that we're working really closely with the third sector, who I think have got an important role to play in this. And then they play that important role right across the country, but I think in remote rural areas in Scotland, we can utilise the third sector to help us with some of those challenges around access. That's not to say statutory services shouldn't do what we need them to do and what we require them to do, but I think there's an ability to use and invest in the third sector more than perhaps we currently do.
You've already touched on this morning, you've mentioned the suicide bereavement services that are taking place, and we know there's pilots taking place already in Ayrshire, Narn and in Highland. So that is also the potential for that to become much more widespread and become much more of a national campaign across Scotland. Are there plans for that to take place? And can the Cabinet Secretary outline what other forms of support are available to families affected by suicide and what further developments are planned to try and once again bridge that gap?
So a couple of things. I'll let Hugh come in on some of the specifics, but of course we're evaluating the projects that Alexander Stewart will evaluate the projects Alexander Stewart rightly raises, and look to see how we can upscale them. And I'm the first person to say within government that far too often we suffer from you know, pilotitis, you know, the inability to go from pilot to upscaling, and we've got to be better at that. I think we are getting better at that. I think if the pandemic taught us anything, it's perhaps having a slightly bigger risk appetite than we often do. You know, not everything, when you upscale it, you don't have to, you know, perfection shouldn't be the enemy of progress. So we should be able to upscale things and realise that there may well be faults and glitches that we'll have to work through. But generally speaking, we should be able to upscale far quicker than I think we currently do when things are going right. In terms of the other matters that Alexander Stewart raises, a lot of this is within the strategy that we referenced. Just remind me your very last question. Sorry, I did have a response.
The further developments that are planned,
yes,
and also what families are affected by suicide,
yes,
how are they supported?
Yes. Families affected by suicide. So, I mean, first of all, obviously, we want to try to prevent as many suicides as we possibly can. That's a core part of the strategy. I think there's a lot of work going on with the third sector in relation to the support that we can offer somebody and families that have suffered, and not just families, you know, understanding that this has an impact on entire communities. In my constituency in Glasgow and Glasgow Pollock, throughout the course of the pandemic, we saw some really tragic cases, a number of tragic cases of young men and women, but who'd completed suicide, and their entire communities that were rocked by it. So a lot of the work is on the preventative. Obviously, we'll put work into the supporting and the bereavement support, but a lot of focus on the preventative, and a lot of that focus going because we know what the statistics tell us about young males in particular, and how they're disproportionately completing suicide. So there's a lot of focus going into that space. But Hugh, you may have a bit more on
just a bit more on the first point. The pilot. So the pilot's completed its first year, and as you're probably aware, the evaluation of the first year of the pilot's been published. We've moved into second year of funding of those pilots. We are working with the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group on the development of, you know, implementing what we've learned in the first year and the second year. So that's going to be guided particularly by the lived experience panel that they have and the youth advisory group as we take that work forward. So there's really work going on to further enhance what we're getting from those pilots, and then we'll move towards what we can do to extend that further.
Thank you, convener.
Can I say also just, I mean, because I think it's very important to come back to what the petitioner you know, had said. I don't want there to be any illusion that we don't think bereavement support can be improved, because, you know, the petitioner made it very clear that they have not had that support and they don't feel that they've had that support for them or their family. So although we have support and we can give detail of that, I don't want there to be any misunderstanding that we don't think that can be improved.
Thank you.
Can I come back to the petitioner? And you've made reference to her courage and the petition she's raised, and obviously we felt that very much in the evidence that she gave. And we did explore with her the aspect of what happens in an acute situation. If somebody has a heart attack or if somebody's having elective surgery, that's all clear. But in the hierarchy of mental health services, what do you do? And, you know, Karen said that when you, in a crisis, phone NHS 24, and I quote from her, to get help for mental health or to speak to an out-of-hours doctor or anything like that, you're told either to contact the police if you feel you cannot keep yourself or someone else safe, or to attend accident and emergency. And I think she felt very much that attending accident and emergency and being with people who were attending accident and emergency for physical health reasons, not mental health reasons, just was not the appropriate place to be in those circumstances at all. What's your reflection on that that kind of thought?
So you'll know and be aware, Convener, I was obviously previously Justice Secretary before this role, and I have to say, and I don't use this word lightly, I mean, it's a real failure in our approach that we will have police officers attend somebody who's in distress and be with them for 5 hours. You know, it's not good for the individual who's suffering that distress, because the police officer who does an excellent job, given the circumstances, they will be the first to say that they're not the best person to help with their mental health needs. So it's not best use of the police officer's time, clearly not the best for the individual involved, and it's not good for the system as a whole, either in terms of the response that we're giving to people. So that in itself is a failure of the approach, and lays bare some of the failings that the petitioner spoke about when she gave evidence in Luke's case. But I suspect that, I know Luke's case is not an isolated one. And so we often talk about mental health being on a par with physical health. And I think, of course, from a government's perspective in terms of priority, that is absolutely true. I don't think that we're seeing the evidence of that cascaded right throughout the entirety of the system. So the example that you give is a very good one, hence why we have set up in recent years, 2020, the NHS 24 Mental Health Hub, so that people have that access nationally to, including to clinical specialists in relation to the distress that they're facing from a mental health perspective. There's also, again, going back to, I suppose, common theme of pilots, there's a number of pilots that we've run across the country, and again, evaluating, some of them actually have now been evaluated, where we've seen a much better model. So again, if I think back to, I think it was in Govan actually, in the south of Glasgow, where we saw where a call came into the police because somebody was really worried about the possibility of somebody seriously harming themselves. The police officer would go with a CPN, would go with that specialist nurse, attend the incident, and I'll not quote exact figures, but if I remember correctly, the amount of officer time that was then spent in that situation reduced more than halved. But I wonder if maybe I'm better passing to one set to Alistair, who may be able to speak from a clinical perspective on the question that you've asked.
We've been doing a lot of work around unscheduled care pathways for mental health, and NHS 24 Hub has been referred to certainly as the starting point for many, but then also many people do attend themselves to accident emergency or emergency departments. What we've done over the last year is ensure that in every board area across Scotland that there is a senior clinic. We use the term senior clinical decision maker because these are different people in different places. In many places it's a nurse, in some places it might be a doctor. But senior clinical decision maker available so that NHS 24 can make that contact. The rationale for that being that for some people, attendance at hospital and assessment by specialist mental health services may be exactly what they need. But for others, there may be a requirement for other services such as distress brief intervention that we've described before. So it's very much about trying to ensure that there is that clear pathway which can avoid the need for people to come to the emergency department as the first port of call, but also acknowledges that some people just do that anyway, and therefore can be picked up from there.
Thank you. I mean, she wasn't able to give the latest figure, but it was quite a high number of incidences. I think she had figures that said about 600 or something of people who had presented at A&E or something like that. Obviously, Karen's experience very much influences the view that she has of everything that, you know, that Luke experienced. And I don't want to be superficial or simply to react to an individual circumstance, but she felt there was a suggestion, or she felt there was an impression, that the risk assessments that had been done had partly been coloured by a view to play down the likely seriousness of the issue rather than to take the issue, to escalate it, and that there was almost a kind of drift to try and achieve that, which in his case, obviously, she feels doesn't point to that in isolation, but feels that meant that his higher risk status really wasn't arrived at a point where something could have been done. Is that I mean, it's very easy to generalise or not to really know, but what's your sense of that?
Risk assessment isn't an exact science, is the first thing in that. So what risk assessment tools have been brought in to support mental health decision making are very inexact. They can be helpful in bringing people towards a decision, but ultimately clinical judgment really needs to come into this. That sense of downplaying, I think can be misinterpreted to some extent, because as a clinician, my view would always be to look to try and find a way to help somebody get the help and support they need without the need for them to escalate into hospital admission or ultimately detention under the Mental Health Act. So you'd always be looking to use the least restrictive option, and from a clinical perspective, that would always be the aim, would be to look to try and manage with the least restriction and the least intervention. But clearly, a risk assessment that indicates a high level of risk and a lack of immediate safety, you would look then to find a safe option, which the only one might be admission to hospital.
Thank you. Monica Lennon is not here to take evidence from our witnesses this morning, but just before I ask the Cabinet Secretary if there's anything you'd like to say in conclusion, Monica, is there anything you'd like to say to the committee that the Cabinet Secretary can also hear and perhaps might want to touch upon in his final remarks, if he has any to make?
Thank you, Convener. Again, grateful to have the opportunity to be here in support of Karen McEwen, the petitioner. As everyone knows, Karen's partner, Luke Henderson, died by suicide in December of 2017. So this is a difficult time for Karen, her children and the wider family. And we meet at a time when it can be difficult for many of our constituents. I know many of us welcomed the opportunity to take part in a debate in Parliament today on male suicide. That debate will have to wait now until the new year, but these are issues that are of concern to all of us. I'm grateful to the committee because I think the session today with the Cabinet Secretary and his officials has been really, really great in the sense that, you know, the Cabinet Secretary is not trying to put any spin on this. You know, I know that he's very sincere about the challenges. I think it was reassuring at the beginning that he said, although there might be a different outlook to how we get there in terms of process, but you know, the Cabinet Secretary, the government and Karen McEwen, they want the same thing. You know, frankly, one suicide is one too many. So we can examine the numbers and the data, as important as that is. And I think targets have a role to play because we have to monitor progress. But ultimately, we're all here because we want to save lives. I think committee members have asked really pertinent questions, including about the wider impact on families and communities. And I've been scribbling some notes here because although we're focused rightly on what happens within the NHS in terms of, you know, primary care, access to GPs, NHS 24, mental health hubs and so on, but there's a wider piece of work here. And I think that's why it's good that the committee has kept this petition open, because I've made notes here about employers, about education, because we all have to become more literate about mental health. Frankly, I struggle to signpost constituents to the right place as a regional MSP, working across two different health boards, three different local authorities. Pilot schemes are welcome, but it can be difficult, you know, to know what is the pathway. And as MSPs sitting in this committee room today, we might all have different systems and different, you know, procedures to point people to. Ultimately, what Karen, as the petitioner, has highlighted, that, you know, her partner, Luke, who had a history of mental illness, you know, who had, you know, relevant medical history, Karen and Luke knew how to ask for help. So they did the right things. They reached out many, many times and still couldn't get the help they need. So I welcome the work that is in the pipeline for next year. But, and I don't doubt the good intentions of the Cabinet Secretary and the government, but we have serious problems that I know the committee's well aware of in terms of resourcing and workforce. And I want to pay tribute to the workforce because actually what I'm seeing increasingly is a workforce that is really struggling and the impact it's having on mental health and wellbeing for workforce. So we have to be really honest about that. I think the Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right, and I think it's really good that he is able to take a wider view, you know, his background in justice and so on. Because frankly, when Karen McKeown and I met with former public health minister after I raised this tragic case with the First Minister a number of years ago, when we talked about some of the issues that Paul Sweeney's got into about, you know, drug disorder, we've not talked about alcohol, but that's a big issue. We were told in that meeting by Claire Hawkey at that time, who was the minister, who is a mental health professional, oh, well, this strand of work is, you know, that's from a public health minister colleague and I'm the mental health minister. We have to get away from that siloed thinking. I think we are seeing some progress on that. But I think the reason why this petition is so important is because we need this constructive challenge to continue, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary does welcome it, because we don't yet have answers around resourcing and how we're actually going to deliver on these really good intentions. And that's what Karen's talked about in the petition, because, you know, without going into details of individual constituents and others in different parts of Scotland, I know people this week who have tried to phone their GP to get an appointment to discuss their mental health and the fact that they're not struggling. And they have, you know, dozens of times, probably over a matter of 2 days, over 100 times. And all other colleagues have raised this in the chamber with the Cabinet Secretary. So that's the reality. So I think what we need to do is, how do we close that gap between, you know, what we want people to think is an offer, for people to have the hope and know they're not alone, but then for some people, the waiting times. I've got lots of stats here about people in Lanarkshire, for example, who are waiting several months, if not years, for psychological therapy. So that's, I think, the business. It's that granular detail about how are we actually going to do this. So again, like everyone else, I pay tribute to Karen. I know today she's listening. I'm looking at my phone. She's messaging me. This is a difficult time for families with lived experience of this, but hopefully they know that we as a parliament are taking this really seriously.
Okay, thank you very much, Monica Lennon. Cabinet Secretary, anything you'd like? I mean, I would like to just comment on the sincerity and sensitivity with which everybody has addressed the issues this morning. I mean, it's been a very constructive discussion. Cabinet Secretary, anything you'd like to say just in conclusion?
Well, just a couple of things. One, obviously, Convener, will go through you to get you the additional information that was asked for by some members, Paul Sweeney and David Torrance in particular, and obviously cascade that to other committee members. I suppose where I started my opening contribution, which is to thank Karen for her bravery. I've not met with her, but I'd be happy to, if Monica wishes to be in touch with my office to speak to her directly. And I think for me, if I can just give an absolute, give you as much reassurance as I possibly can, and hopefully Karen as much reassurance, there's nobody in government, certainly not me as the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, that comes to this issue just with defensive walls up, saying this is all the great stuff that we're doing. And there is a lot of good work going on in the workforce. If I look at CAMHS, for example, are seeing more people than they've ever seen before, but the demand is huge. So nobody's coming up with defensive walls to say we've got it all right, it's fine, and the odd exception, you know, people are failed here and there. Actually, what we're saying is there are some serious systemic issues, some of those pre-pandemic, a lot of them exacerbated by the pandemic, and there's a joint cross-government working that is taking place to try to address some of those issues. It will take time, but I certainly want nobody to have the experience that Luke did, and we'll do everything we can, not just through a strategy, but the implementation of that suicide prevention strategy, to make sure that we reduce the number of suicides in Scotland in the years to come. But happy to follow up in writing, as I say, Convener, on some of the issues that have been raised that we haven't been able to give additional detail today on.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you very much to you and your colleagues for joining us this morning. Very much appreciate that. Colleagues, are we content to hear to consider the evidence to subsequent meeting? We are. That concludes our business for today. We next meet on the 18th of January next year, and on that basis, I'm happy to close the meeting. Thank you.